a PAGCOR official in the hearing said that you made 6 calls on behalf of Cassandra Ong at one point. Not once did you mention Whirlwind, which is the company you claim to be representing, but then you've always kept mentioning Lucky South in the phone call. So there are two things here. You may not be the legal representative, there may be no proof, but why make 6 calls in behalf of Cassandra Ong? Why go to the PAGCOR office, speak to the chairman and assist, and I'm using the word assist, speak in behalf of Cassandra Ong regarding the billings of Lucky South 99. Why would you do that?
Well, let me say first and foremost, I'm a lawyer. Lawyers do this. Lawyers ensure that people that they assist are in compliance with the law.
And you don't find that you're a legal representative?
No, not yet. Let me explain. No?
Okay.
There's nothing wrong with what I did. That's what I'm saying. Is there anything criminal with accompanying someone for rescheduling of payment? Mm. Is there anything legal to make sure that an entity that requires a government license should be in compliance with all the requirements? Mm. If that's the only basis of linking me to the POGOs, it's very clear nothing illegal happened. There was no misconduct whatsoever. Now, the issue of attorney-client relationship is very well defined under the canons of professional responsibility by jurisprudence. It is viewed from the perspective of the client. A client-attorney relationship begins when the client reposes in a lawyer the confidence and trust to perform legal services. But jurisprudence also says that there must be a meeting of the minds between the attorney and the client. Now, when I represented Whirlwind by accompanying Cassie Ong to PAGCOR, she represented herself as the lessor of Lucky South. She represented herself as someone also providing services to their lessor, because if they have no license, then they would also have no client. Mm-hmm. And that was in the context of asking me to assist them when they found out that they were a victim of swindling. Apparently, they had paid their legal representative to PAGCOR, Dennis Gorenan, allegedly 500,000, which was not in turn paid to PAGCOR.
Okay.
So yesterday, I already said that when they approached me, it was for legal assistance, and I didn't want to accept the engagement for legal assistance for suing because I said, you know, he's my neighbor. I cannot sue my neighbor.
All right. You know? No, I think what you're trying to establish here, and I get you, is the fact that there's not enough evidence to actually claim that you are the legal counsel of Lucky South 99. The paper is not enough. So what I want to ask you, actually, I'm curious, Attorney Roque, who is the president of Whirlwind?
Well, what I know is I dealt with 2 people on Whirlwind, no? And they were in the articles of incorporation, no? Cassie Ong and a Chinese person by the name of Mr. Wu. So I met 2 of them, and I also met a non-resident Singaporean CEO. And the context by which I met Whirlwind was not really because they were engaged in real estate, leasing premises to a POGO, but because I had met them in a forum of renewable energy, at least that CEO, no?
Yeah, and so they own the 10 hectares, attorney? The 10 hectares where Lucky South is, Whirlwind owns that?
They lease it, the land, and they built the buildings, no? And they in turn leased it, no? But I met Whirlwind as a potential investor in renewable energy, in solar projects, no? And that's why for a year, I was trying to convince them to consider 2 projects that I was pushing for, 2 in Cebu, 1 in Sogod, and 1 in Daan Bantayan, no? And that's the context by which I knew Cassie Ong as an employee of Whirlwind, and that's why, you know, I had no interest at all in their involvement with POGOs. I wanted an investor in my solar energy projects.
Okay, so Whirlwind essentially leased the land as well, tama, right?
Hindi. They don't own the land. They own partially of the land, pero hindi pa nila fully paid.
Uh-oh.
So they built the buildings, the 49 buildings, and leased it to Lucky South together with all the equipment.
Okay, but why would they build the 49 buildings unless they're already in a previous contract with Lucky South? Would that be fair, right? Why would you build 49 buildings unless you know POGO is coming into the property? Is that correct?
No, I mean, it was built in 2019. It was leased to Lucky South. It was really built as a POGO because Lucky South already had a 3-year license.
Yeah, yeah. So, and by this time, I mean, just for factual purposes, POGO was legalized during that time. That's the premise there. So at the end, would you know the president of Lucky South?
Well, I only met two of them and that CEO who is a non-resident. No, I understand the CEO is not really an officer of... No, I do not know anyone from Lucky South, if that is a question. That's the thing. That's why no matter if I did service beneficial to Lucky South, there is no attorney-client relation because I did not see anyone from Lucky South. Mm. And that's what I say.
Except Cassandra Ong.
Except from Cassie Ong. And what's apparent now is no one knows who's Lucky South. No? So if no one knew who Lucky South is at the time of its corporation, how would I know? And why would I claim to be a lawyer of Lucky South? And that is consistent with what I'm saying, that I have never met a soul representing Lucky South, and I knew Cassie Ong as an employee of Whirlwind. I had no doubts that Cassie Ong was an employee of Whirlwind because I have dealt with them for about a year already trying to persuade them to invest in a solar project.
Mm-hmm. Now, Lucky South 99 was raided in 2022, and it's a legitimate question. You were asked this in Congress. Why would you help them, Attorney Roque? You were the former spokesperson of President Duterte. So you do have some saying that you were really wielding your political influence to assist, to help this POGO company. Why would you help them after a track record that they've been raided in 2022?
Karen, that's a wrong premise because under the old system, a mother licensee such as Lucky South could have sub-licensee. And what the entity raided in 2022 was a sub-licensee. Mm. And why do I say this? Because if they were already raided in 2022, why would they still be allowed to operate until 2024? I think they have cleared the issue that what was raided was a sub-licensee and not the mother licensee. And secondly, at that time when they were raided, I had no dealings at all with them. I had no idea they existed. And I did not know the relevance of that news that they were raided, no, because they were not in my realm of existence at all. No, but the important thing to underscore here is, if they were already raided, then why did PAGCOR allow them to continue to operate until 2024? Mm. And the only rational explanation is precisely the system of sub-licensing, and that the entity that was raided was a sub-licensee, which was not in the premises in Porac, but it was in Angeles City.
Okay. Now, the Department of Justice has issued an immigration lookout bulletin against you and 11 others to close. After the hearing in the Senate, another hearing in the House, possibly, that you might attend to, and now an immigration lookout against yourself. What do you think of all of this, Attorney Roque? Because now it seems that it's not proving yourself, it's not perceived innocent before guilty. It's in the reverse. You'd have to prove to the public you're not involved in POGOs.
Thank you very much, Karen. Highlighting, of course, that POGOs were legal, no? And that Lucky South was legal until 2024. Well, I already believe that this is harassment. It's clear that my only involvement is I accompanied Cassie Ong, not even for renewal of license. No? It was for rescheduling of payment, no? Number one. And that number two, the fugitive is a completely different issue. In fact, the lookout bulletin is on the Porac issue. But as far as the Porac issue is concerned, other than accompanying Cassie Ong, there's not been any allegations at all of any misconduct. So why would they put me in a lookout bulletin? Mm. Well, of course, lookout bulletin would not affect my right to travel. No? Mm. And there's jurisprudence involving former President GMA, no? That said that only courts can issue a whole departure order. But already it is really trial by publicity because they even published, no, the conditions by which the lookout bulletin was issued and that there's possibility of a grave crime being committed. But Karen, months after the raid in Porac, the only case they have filed is for torture against two Chinese nationals, no? And that's even a wrong charge because a torture can only be committed by state agents for purposes of extracting information. And there hasn't been any case filed at all. So why would they now have come? Why would they now issue a lookout bulletin, including me, when my only participation was for arranging rescheduling of payment? So to me, it's plain harassment. And I think you cannot separate this now from the fact that since Maisug and since the breakdown of Uniteam, I have been a very vocal critic of this administration.
All right. On that note, I want to thank you for joining me today on Head Start. Attorney Harry Roque, thank you, sir.
And Karen, thank you very much for this opportunity to be heard. I really appreciate it.
All right. Thank you, sir.